Good morning everyone, myself Sanjeev Kumar. Today in this lecture we are going to discuss about characteristics of series generator. Now we know that series generator always the series field winding and armature both are connected in series, so that's why it is called as series generator. So I am representing the resistances. Now anyhow, this is a prime mover DC motor and this is the DC generator actually, and the armature current, series current and the load current both are same. I connected 1 voltmeter across armature and series, again 1 voltmeter across the load. Now the procedure to find out 3 characteristics: no load characteristics, internal characteristics and external characteristics is different from your shunt generator and separately excited, so similar to separately. Now since DC generator armature, series and load currents 3 are same, so I have to excite the series field winding separately so that I can get the field current versus no load EMF characteristics. Since field current is also connected in series with the armature, so if the current flowing through field winding will be equal to the armature current, so load current is also produced. So that's why I have to exert separately the series winding of DC series generator, so that what is the induced EMF in this generator I will find out. Now if you draw the no load EMF E naught versus ISE, now the curve will be like this. Now what is the procedure? You have to run the DC generator at the rated speed and slowly increase the field current so that the generated EMF is also increases. Now what happens here, you can observe from, now this is the field current, so ISE, and this is the no load EMF E naught, and this is the curve we are obtained from here. You can give it as a O, A, B, C and D. Now OA, what is OA? OA is nothing but residual voltage. This is already in your DC generator due to residual magnetism. So the curve starts from at the point of A, not from the O. Okay, now as your field current is increasing, this induced EMF is also increased at no load, but once the poles get saturated, now this will become constant. That means further you increase the field current, so there is no change in the induced EMF and the poles get saturated. So at this point induced EMF slightly going to downwards and remains constant. Okay, now by giving separate excitation to the series field winding, we will get the no load EMF versus field current characteristics like this. And for internal characteristics, what is the internal characteristics? Internal characteristics are always drawn between generated, actually generated EMF versus load current or armature currents. Okay, now here armature current, load current both are same. Now what is the value of generated EMF? So no load induced EMF minus armature reaction drop due to demagnetizing effect and due to cross magnetizing effect, you will get the curve like this. Now AB is the no load curve, no load or OCC curve. Then AC is nothing but OC is equal to internal characteristic curve. Internal characteristic curve, you can see here there is an armature reaction drop, so this voltage is going downwards. Since this y-axis is voltage terms, so this much amount of voltage is dropped due to demagnetizing effect as well as cross magnetizing effect. Now the point comes to C. Now what is C? C is the point at where you are getting the actual generated EMF. Now this is OC is nothing but EG versus ISE, IL and IS, since all the currents are same. Okay, Now no load and internal characteristics are completed. Now to draw the load characteristics, nothing but we can call it as a OD, which is nothing but external characteristics. Now to draw the external characteristics, what you have to do, you have to close the DPST switch and the load current starts flow into the load. Since armature current, series current, load current both are same, so you have to limit the load current, the demagnetizing effect on your armature, MMF will be less. So as you are increasing the load current, now the load voltage also starts increasing. Okay. This voltage, load voltage also starts increasing since armature current, series current and load current all are same. So the curve will be like this. Now at this point your voltage will be remains same, but after this point further you increase the load, now the voltage starts drops. Now what is the reason? The demagnetizing effect on your armature increases. Now if this effect increases, now the voltage going to drop. So it is shown by dotted lines. Lines show here the load current remains constant and the load voltage starts decreasing. Now what is the reason for this decrement is the voltage? Now just now we said as the load current increases, so load voltage is also increases. But the reason for here is you have to understand. So what is the relation for voltage and generated EMF? We know that Eg is equal to V plus Ia into Ra plus Rac. Now as the load current increasing, armature current is also starts increasing. Now same armature current is also flowing through the series field winding, so the series flux is also increases. Now until the flux increases, so this voltage increases. But once the poles saturates, once the pole saturated, so this flux remains constant, so there is no further change in the generated EMF. Now if the generated EMF is constant, now this V plus IARA has to be adjusted to balance this. Now what you observe from here? So as Ia is increasing, now Eg is going to be constant, so this voltage starts decreasing. Now as the voltage starts decreasing, the load current depends upon this voltage. Now load current is also starts slowly decreasing. But once your voltage starts to drop, now this armature current is going to be remains constant. So that's why the series generator is also called as a constant current generator. Since the dotted line represents the decrement in the voltage due to armature, series and load currents all are same. Now same current is flowing through armature, series and load. So due to same current, armature MMF affected by demagnetizing effect as well as, and this series flux will be saturates the poles, and this load current may remain same since the voltage is going to drop. Now this dotted line shows the same thing. As your voltage is going to be drop, further your load current is going to increase since Eg is going to be constant. Now this is the total analysis of series generator. You can observe from the curves there is a two drops, one is armature and a series field resistance. So series field resistance is less than armature resistance, so drop in this generator is very less since the armature current or load current or series current is in the limits. Once the current increases, so the drop in armature and series resistance is also, so which leads to less generated, less voltage across the loads. Okay, now like this the series generators, we discussed about the no load EMF versus field current, that is nothing but OCC, and second one is generated EMF versus armature current or load current, and third one is load voltage versus load current. Now the DC series generators mainly used for voltage boosters. If you see the characteristics like this, now these characteristics will be used for the boosting purpose. The voltage will be increases until this point, so that we can use for increasing the voltages when there is a decrement in the applications. So like this, the series generators are used as a voltage boosters, you can often see. And also the series current, armature current and load currents are same. It can be loaded up to the rated load currents. Now we will discuss the DC compound generator characteristics. We know already the DC shunt generator voltage drops slightly less than the rated voltage when it is loaded. Now by adding the extra series turns, we can keep the voltage which is equal to the no load voltage, no load EMF. So that can be the base for DC compound generator, since you can see here. So field winding and armature is generally for this is shunt generator. Now extra turns are added. Now this will be the compound. Now these extra turns, series turns are added to armature so that it can supply the extra EMF to the armature generated voltage, so that it can compensate the armature drop, armature reaction drop and armature resistance drop. Now by adding the extra number of turns in series, with you can also see the pole. So when it is, now this is the normal field winding, so you can also call it a shunt field winding, and extra number of series turns are also added so that can supply the extra EMF to the generated voltage. Now we can observe here, we are having the no load EMF is same as full load EMF, that means with rated voltage we can call it as a flat compound. That means whatever the your generated EMF is equal to voltage, or we can also call it as a no load voltage is equal to generated voltage, then it can be called as a flat compounded. So rated voltage will be equal to generated voltage. So we are compensating the armature reaction and a resistance drop. Now when this voltage will be, this generated voltage will be less than the voltage, then we can call it as a over compounding. And if the load voltage is less than your generated voltage, then it is called as the under compounded generator. Now it is possible by making the series flux and armature flux both are aided, so the resultant flux will be higher, so we can get the generated EMF is larger. We know that generated EMF Eg is equal to pi ZnV by 60, since Eg is proportional to pi into N. Now if we assume pi is, n is constant, so Eg is proportional to pi. Now what is this pi? Pi is the total flux which can generate. So Eg is proportional to pi sh plus pi sc. We are having the two fluxes. If both fluxes are added, so the resultant flux will be increases. So the generated EMF is also increases. If the series flux opposes the shunt flux, then that will be the case divided into a cumulative compound and a differential compound generators. So what is it? Differential compound, differentially compound, where resultant flux is pi sh minus pi sc. Now, if it is cumulative, if it is a cumulative, pi r equal to pi sh plus pi sc. So, resultant flux will be increases. Now, depending upon our applications, we can use for the constant voltages. To make the constant voltages, we can apply the extra series term to keep the voltage constant. Now, this is the flat compound, under compound and over compound generators. Now, by studying these characteristics, generally we will use over compound generators in industrial purpose so that the voltage drop will be less when it is going to be loaded, so it can operate at the rated voltage. Similarly, cumulative and differential compounds also makes the constant voltage, so when it is going to be loaded, the cross magnetizing and demagnetizing effects are also going to be less affected in these generators.
Now we will discuss about critical field resistance or critical resistance. Now it is the resistance at which beyond this resistance your generator will not build up any voltage. That means it is the maximum value of resistance. It is the maximum value of resistance. Beyond this, beyond it, the generator would not build up voltage. You can call it as EMF, generated EMF. So, what is the need of critical field resistance here, especially in DC shunt generators? Now, you can see here your DC shunt generator having field and it is connected. Now, this is the armature IA and this is shunt. And this is load current. We know that IA is equal to IL plus ISH. Now you already know that the generated EMF is equal to pi ZNP by 60 into A, whereas PG is proportional to pi into F. Now if N is also constant, now EG is proportional to pi, whereas pi is proportional to field current. Now you can say that EG is proportional to IF, so that EG is equal to some constant K into IF. Now if you increase the field current, the generated EMF is also increases. But there is a concept of residual magnetism. So, what is residual magnetism? We know about the hysteresis loop of magnetic materials. So, a small amount of energy will be in the armature conductors, that is called as the residual magnetism. Due to this, this already having the some EMF in these conductors. So, just to initiate the flux cutting action for this armature, now build up of generator voltage will be stops. That means small amount of field current will be flow through this, which creates a flux and which is cut by armature conductors. Now slowly the induced EMF increases and again it supplies the current and then will cut the flux again. So this cycling process continues until it generates the rated voltage. Now to flow the minimum current to the your shunt field winding, with shunt field winding having high resistance, since it is connected in parallel and it is having the high resistance and low current rating. So what is the value of current you require to flow through this winding? Now what is the value of resistance you should, and what is the limit you are going to give for the shunt field winding? So that limit will be given by critical field resistance. Now, the maximum value of resistance at beyond this generator may not build up the voltage. That means if this resistance is very high, the field current may not be getting to this. If the field current may be come here, but that may not induce the EMF in this armature conductors. Okay, so that will be given by this critical field resistance. Now, how we are going to find out critical field resistance? You simply draw the OCC. Okay, the critical field resistance is determined by, so this is the field current and this is the no load EMF, and this EMF starts from the point where you are getting. So what is OA? OA is the residual voltage. Now at this point, this EMF starts increasing and it goes a maximum value. Again, it is going to remain constant or slowly decreasing. Now, what is the value of resistance we are going to give for this? Now, just we have to find out what is the value of armature, what is the value of critical field resistance for this. You just draw a tangential line by using shunt field resistance. Okay, now this is the OCC curve. Okay. Now we are having the shunt resistance. Now we are having the shunt resistance RSH. Now if you draw the shunt resistance line tangential to this, now it may cross across at somewhere here. Now it is crossing the OCC at this point. Now if you find out the slope of that curve, that will give the resistance, which is called as the critical field resistance. Now, if you determine that resistance, that will be the maximum value of resistance at which this generator is failed to build up. Beyond that voltage, it is going to fail to build up. Now, to find out that, you just draw a line here and you find out the slope of this curve. So let us say C, D, E. Now what is the value of critical field resistance? ED divided by CD. Now what is ED? ED is nothing but volts and CD is nothing but current, field current. Now we can determine what is the value of critical field resistance. Maximum resistance, beyond it, this generator is failed to produce the EMF. Now, this is the simple process to determine the critical field resistance. Draw the OCC line and draw the tangential line. For this, you will determine the critical field resistance. Now, we will discuss about critical speed. So, what is meant by critical speed? So at shunt resistance, where it will becomes critical field resistance, that speed is called as the critical speed. So what is the definition? The shunt field resistance, becomes critical resistance. That speed called as critical speed. Now generally shunt field resistance is in the hundredth order. So where it will becomes the maximum value. Nothing but if you see your OCC. Now this is the OCC generally. So this is a critical field resistance. So shunt field resistance. Now where it will becomes critical, nothing but a tangent. So at this resistance will becomes critical field resistance. Now at this speed where your shunt resistance is coinciding but tangential to the OCC, that speed called as a critical speed. Where your shunt field becoming critical resistance, shunt field resistance is becoming critical field resistance, that speed is called as the critical speed. We know that from the generated EMF, Eg is equal to pi Znp by 60A. So since Z is constant, P is 60A is constant, E is proportional to pi into N. Now assume pi is constant. Now E is proportional to N. Now if E increases, N is also increases, E decreases, N is also decreases. Now by using this, we can determine the critical speed. Now let us see how we are going to determine the critical speed of a DC generator. Now to determine this critical speed, first we have to draw the OCC. So this is field current and this is no load EMF. Now the first point is draw the OCC for rated speed. Okay, draw the OCC for rated speed. Now it is starting from A, it reaches the B point. So this is the starting, and draw the tangential to this. Now this is the tangential to this line. Let us say this is some C. OB is the AB is the OCC and OC is the tangential line. And now you make the speed at a different. By keeping the same field, you run the motor at different speed. Okay. Now if you run the motor at different speed, now what will be the new OCC? Now it may be like this. So this is new OCC and call it as a D. But the field current is same. Okay. Now you say this is the field current and getting the same. Okay. Now what you observe from this, the field current is same, but the generated voltage will be like this. That means the generated voltage will be different. We know that E is proportional to pi into N, and E is proportional to N since flux is constant. So flux is nothing but field current. Now if field current is constant, so EMF generated will changes, so that the value of speed is also changes. Now this is a new OCC at the speed of N. Okay, now we just extend the lines left hand side. Now this will be E1, this will be E, and this will be the E1. Now what you observe from this, if speed increases, generated EMF is also increases. If speed decreases, the generated EMF is also decreases. Now what is the value of speed you will get where your critical field resistance will become, your shunt resistance will become critical field resistance. Now what you observe, for the speed N, the EMF will be E. Now for the speed N1, the EMF will be E1. Now N1 will be the critical speed since it is having the same field current and the critical field resistance where it is going to cross the line. Now we will discuss about the critical speed. Now what is mean by critical speed? Critical speed is nothing but the shunt field resistance will becomes critical field resistance, and at which speed it is running is called as the critical speed. So what is mean by this? So shunt field resistance becomes critical field resistance, nothing but the shunt field resistance becomes maximum value. Beyond it may not generate any voltage. Now at that speed which generator is running is called as the critical speed. Now this critical speed is obtained, you can see here, in previous case we already discussed about critical resistance. Now if you draw the OCC, Now we draw the tangential line to this. Now where you are getting the critical field resistance, that means it is the maximum resistance you can put up to your field winding. So if you increase beyond this, your generated EMF may not be possible. So at this resistance, the motor running speed is called as the critical speed. Okay. Now how you determine this critical speed? What is the procedure to determine the critical speed? So we know the relation between generated EMF, flux and speed. So Eg is equal to pi z Np by 16 to A. Since number of conductors, poles, 60 parallel paths, all are constant. Now Eg is proportional to pi into N. Now what I am doing, I am keeping flux constant. Now if you put keep flux into constant, Eg is proportional to speed. Now Eg is equal to some constant into speed. Now if I increase the Eg, speed increases. If speed decreases, Eg also decreases. Now I am utilizing this condition to determine the critical speed. Okay. Now what you have to do, first you have to do the first point is at rated speed draw the OCC. Okay, that is nothing but rated speed is at N1, I am drawing the OCC. Okay, next, by keeping same field current, draw new OCC at N2. Okay, new speed, I am taking the new speed and drawing the new OCC, so the field current is still same, but now the speed will be new speed. So what happens if you change the speed? You change the speed, generated EMF is also changes. Okay, next, the third one is draw the tangential line to OCC 1. OCC at N1. Now I draw tangential line OC to the first speed, that is N1 speed OCC. Next, fourth one is draw the shunt resistance. Now I draw the shunt resistance line also. Okay. Now, up to these four points you have to follow, that means draw the OCC two times and draw the tangential line and draw the shunt resistance line. Now, the fifth point is from the tangential curve. At the any point of tangential curve, you draw the vertical line and horizontal line which intersects the shunt field resistance line. Okay. That means draw a vertical and a horizontal line which intersects RSH and horizontally extended. Okay. Now, which is intersecting at the point G and which is starting from the H. Now, from the H you extend it into left side, this is the volts, Y axis, now E1, E2. Now, for the N1 speed, the induced EMF will be E1 and for the N2 speed, the induced EMF will be E2. But what is this speed? Now, this speed will becomes critical speed. So what is the reason? We know that E is proportional to N, E1 by N1 equal to E2 by N2. Now since we don't know the E2, E2 is equal to N2 by N1 into E1. Now what is this? So N2 will find out the N2 for this. Okay, E1 by E2 is proportional to, remove it. E1 by E2 is equal to N1 by N2. Similarly, N2 by N1 equal to E2 by E1. So, N2 is equal to N1 into E2 by E1. Now, this N2 will become critical speed since the shunt resistance is becoming the critical field resistance. So, your critical field resistance is appearing here. The same I'm drawing here. So, we will get the critical speed of this generator. Now, this will be the calculation for critical speed and also critical resistance.